Morant with a running start. Elevates. Oh, it dunks. Oh, my goodness.
Tie game in overtime. Gasol will turn his heat. It's gone. Memphis on top. 7 ticks remain. Conley now with three. Count it. A 15-point lead for Memphis. And Blake Griffin gets into it on the floor with Randolph. Hard to tell if there are any punches being thrown under there, but Griffin took exception.
Adams going long. Morant!
John Morant, insanity!
You gotta be kidding me.
Welcome to Grits and Grinds, a Memphis Grizzlies podcast, Grizzlies Win Edition. My name is Keith Parrish. The Grizzlies beat the Portland Trailblazers, or players wearing Trailblazers jerseys. These were not your regular Trailblazers. The Grizzlies beat an extremely shorthanded Trailblazers squad featuring lots of names you may have never heard of. It was not the most overwhelming and convincing victory. We don't want to overreact to games in April. The end of the season is odd, but it's also hard to come away with much of a positive sensation from this one, especially on the heels of the game against Chicago on Sunday. Again, at the very least, they got the win. They picked up their 50th win of the season. This is the sixth season in franchise history with 50 or more wins. They won their 35th home game. They played their last regular season home game and finished 35-6 at home. Of course, that is a franchise record for the best winning percentage and most wins in a season at home. That is the most home wins in the NBA since the Golden State Warriors in 2017. That stat is from Grizzlies PR. So the Grizzlies' home domination continues. The Grizzlies moved one step closer to locking up the 2 seed. Their magic number is 2. They did not get any help from the Pelicans on Tuesday night. The Pelicans lost to the Kings. So if the Grizzlies win 2 of their final 3 games, they will be the 2 seed. If the Kings lose one, the Grizzlies win one, that's good enough. Any combination of Grizzlies wins and Kings losses that equals 2 locks up the number 2 seed. Now, if you don't want to be concerned about any parts of this game, one stat you could look at is like Jaren Jackson Jr.'s plus minus. The Grizzlies outscored the Blazers by 28 when Jaren was on the court. So you're like, all right, cool, we're fine. The game started off in the Grizzlies' favor. A huge first quarter. They dropped 41 points in the first quarter, led by Luke Kennard. Luke Kennard drills a three-pointer 9 seconds into the game. He ends up making 5 three-pointers in the first quarter. Grizzlies are winning big over a shorthanded Trailblazer squad that was 19.5-point underdogs on Sunday, but won. So you think coming into this game, your final home game of the season, you're aware the Trailblazers upset the Timberwolves in their previous game. You're aware that you played maybe the worst half in franchise history in the second half against the Bulls. And you're thinking, all right, we got to focus. We got to beat this team. And so that they come out, they build a big lead. You're like, great, this is exactly what I want to see. But then the second, third quarters, Taylor Jenkins said after the game that just the defensive attention just totally lapsed. And this Trailblazers team got back in it. The Trailblazers took the lead in the fourth quarter. They were up by 5. In the fourth quarter, as the Grizzlies had a 19-point first-half lead totally erased. I'll keep repeating it, on the heels of having a 23-point lead erased against the Bulls. The Grizzlies were down by 5 in the fourth quarter. Then Jaren checks back in, and the Grizzlies go on a 22-2 run to put the game away. But again, I'm not going to feel super excited or positive about that because the Blazers were playing. Here are the names of the players the Blazers played in the final 8 minutes of the game. Skylar Mays, Jonathan Williams in his second NBA game, a rookie named John Butler, Drew Eubanks, and Justin Manaya. And then at the very last few minutes, they subbed in Shaq Harrison and Jabari Walker. Justin Manaya, he doesn't even have a basketball reference page yet. He played 13 minutes in the second half, isn't listed on Basketball Reference. Shaedon Sharpe, 19-year-old rookie for the Trailblazers, he didn't play in the final 8 minutes of this game. It was tied with 8 minutes left. Shaedon Sharpe checks out, doesn't play again. So, like, the Trailblazers, I think you could argue, they were trying to lose. Of course, the players on the court not trying to lose, but the organization, very comfortable with losing this game. So, no, I'm not going to feel super excited that the Grizzlies pulled away and won. The final minutes where Bane got a great three-pointer on a second-chance opportunity, just wide open. These Trailblazers players who had never played together, have never practiced together. I mean, they literally signed a guy off the street, I mean, figuratively, but a guy who never played with him, Justin Manaya, who played big minutes in this one. And it seemed like the Blazers were exhausted at the end of the game. But Bane hits a big three. You know, that kind of clinched it. He finished with 30 points. This is Bane's eighth 30-point game of the season. The only players in franchise history to have more 30-point games in a single season. Ja Morant, of course, a few times. Sharif Abdul-Rahim and Rudy Gay, they each had 12 30-point games in a season once. Pau Gasol had 11. Mike Conley had 10. Another Mike Conley season had 9, and Zebo had 9. So Desmond Bane, with his eighth 30-point game of the season, he made 5 out of 12 threes. He played the entire second half, except for 2.5 minutes near the end of the third quarter. He played the final 14 minutes of this one. David Roddy played the final 13 minutes of the game. This is the first game of a back-to-back set. They play at New Orleans tonight on Wednesday night. You would think, hey, let's play our main guys just a few minutes. I don't know if they were going to play, you know, on the second night of a back-to-back anyways, but I would guess now, we don't have this information because the injury report won't come out for hours, but I'm going to guess that Bane, who played nearly 37 minutes, is not going to play tonight. I would guess Luke Kennard, who played 34 minutes, maybe he's not going to play tonight. Ja Morant played 35 minutes. These are heavy minutes for your starters because you wanted to win this game. You needed to win this game. Losing this game would have made keeping the 2 seed a very difficult proposition. Give the Grizzlies credit for winning, but do not give them any style points for the fashion in which they achieved the victory. Ja Morant had 23 points, 9 assists, 6 rebounds, a steal, 2 turnovers, a couple of great highlights, a poster dunk on Eubanks, made a great assist to Desmond Bane off of a turnover. It was cool to see. I thought Ja Morant played a fine game, played a pretty nice game. They started Luke Kennard because Dylan Brooks was out. So Dylan Brooks misses this game. Will he play on Wednesday night? I don't know. If I'm a betting man, I'd say maybe, probably. But I'm not going to be surprised if he sits out again to get fully, totally healthy. Luke Kennard got the start. In previous games where Brooks has been out, they started Roddy a couple times. And they said post-game, Taylor Jenkins said that he wanted to see more of the Kennard and Bane minutes alongside Ja Morant. That obviously is a very good offensive lineup. You provide a lot of shooting and spacing, and it worked out in this one. Kennard finished with 20 points overall and 6 made threes after that huge 15-point first quarter. So it's great. You see Bane and Kennard combine for 50 points. I saw the Grizzlies on Twitter retweeted a thing that combined Kennard and Bane's stats. Okay, yes, it is super cool. They combined for 50 points and 11 made threes. But they also combined the plus-minuses. You can't combine individual plus-minuses like you're double-counting the points. Just say they made 11 threes and scored 50 points. That's great. You can't say they combined to go plus 29, plus minus. That doesn't make any sense. Like, Jaren was plus 28 in this game. Kennard was plus 24. You can't say Jaren and Luke combined to go plus 52. It doesn't make any sense. You're counting the same points twice. I hope you understand that. Do not combine individual players, single game plus minuses. That's a little stats lesson for all the listeners here. But Bane and Kennard, the minutes have gone great. The minutes in this game went great. Now for the season, I think this is something that's pretty interesting. For the season, when you play Bane and Kennard together, the Grizzlies, when those two guys are on the court, are shooting 43% from three as a team when those two guys are on the court together. They're shooting 52% overall. They actually have a good defensive rating. Of the 64 two-man lineups for the Grizzlies this year that have played at least 200 minutes together. Bane and Kennard have the best offensive rating as far as two-man lineup combinations, and the second-best net rating, the only combo with a better net rating, is Jaren Jackson Jr. and Santi Aldama. Of course, they don't have very many minutes played. They're 54th out of those 64 combos in minutes played together. But the stats so far when Bane and Kennard play together are very, very promising. So Kennard has a big game, getting the start, 20 points. Bane delivers with 30 points. Morant has 23. Jaren Jackson Jr., 17 points, 7 rebounds, 1 block, a couple of nice assists. Both of those happened in the third quarter. Beyond that, it's kind of a mixed bag. I guess Roddy, you want to highlight Roddy having a pretty nice game. With 16 points off the bench, Roddy tied his career high with 4 made three-pointers. The team overall made 18 three-pointers. The three-point production continues. Now, the flip side of that coin is it seems to be coming at the expense of other things, like forcing turnovers and getting rebounds. They have leaned into some small ball. Tillman's minutes were very, very odd in this one. I'll come back to that. But I think, so since the acquisition of Luke Kennard, Grizzlies' three-pointers are up. The past couple of games, three-pointers are way up. Here's a stat from Sean Coleman. Today's Sean Coleman stat. In Grizzlies franchise history, in the 28 years of the Grizzlies, they've made 18 or more three-pointers 21 times. 7 of those instances have come since March 1st. So they're making a lot more threes now. But it seems to be at the expense of forcing turnovers, getting deflections, getting rebounds. Now, some of the rebounding stuff, it's out of our hands. Something we can't control. No Steven Adams, no Brandon Clark. But for the season, the Grizzlies are 6th in deflections per game. Even post-All-Star break, when there hasn't been Steven Adams, they're 8th in deflections per game. In this game, playing a ragtag bunch of guys signed in the past couple of weeks, basically, the Grizzlies had fewer deflections than the Trailblazers. The Trailblazers had 11 deflections. The Grizzlies had 9. The Trailblazers had 6 loose balls recovered. The Grizzlies had 1. The Grizzlies only picked up 5 steals. The Trailblazers had 7. The Trailblazers out-rebounded the Grizzlies on the offensive glass. 13 offensive rebounds for the Trailblazers to 8 for the Grizzlies. The Trailblazers, this team of, again, none of these guys would be in the top 12 of any NBA team except for maybe Drew Eubanks. Maybe Shaedon Sharpe, I apologize. They didn't play Shaedon Sharpe in the final 8 minutes. They didn't play Kevin Knox in the final quarter. The only guy in the final 8 minutes I think who would be in the top 12 of any NBA team is Drew Eubanks. That team still beat the Grizzlies on second chance scoring. In the Bulls game, of course, the wild statistics from the Bulls game where the Bulls didn't turn the basketball over. The Bulls game, they had 16 deflections. The Bulls had 16 deflections. The Grizzlies had 1 deflection. Those are wild numbers. Of course, the Bulls tied their franchise record for fewest turnovers in a game. The Trailblazers, through 3 quarters, only turned the ball over 5 times. This is players who hadn't been playing together. And they're not turning the basketball over. Our defense isn't good enough to force turnovers and to get our season average in deflections. Like, the dream for the Grizzlies, the dream of adding Luke Kennard and any player we acquire going forward, we're always hoping we can add three-point shooting without losing the other pieces that make the Grizzlies good. The second chance scoring, the perimeter defense, the forcing turnovers. So far, we've basically taken away, like, attribute points. I always think of it like a video game. Like one of those role-playing video games like Fallout or something where you're given attribute points where you can assign to whatever categories you want. Like, do I want to be good at three-point shooting or do I want to be good at rebounding? It's like it's a zero-sum game. I can either add to three-point shooting or take away from defense, take away from deflections. So we're winning in a different style. We're winning with the three-point makes recently. We're not winning, usually, with forced turnovers and second chance scoring. Now, just a few games ago, they forced a ton of turnovers. They got a bunch of steals against the Clippers. So it's not totally gone. But the combination of only forcing six turnovers through seven quarters in the entire Bulls game, plus the first three quarters of the Trailblazers game, not great. The Trailblazers had three turnovers in the fourth quarter, so they only finished with eight, which is pretty good. The Trailblazers' season low for turnovers in a game is seven. So they were close to that. But the Grizzlies not getting those points off of turnovers. They did get out on the fast break, though. They did kind of crush the Trailblazers with fast break points in this one. So that was good. Xavier Tillman had a terrible game. And oddly, he did not start the second half, and I don't know why that was. No one asked Taylor Jenkins about it in the post-game press conference. Of course, I live in Nashville. I don't go to the post-game press conferences. Xavier Tillman in the first quarter got a shot blocked, twice? In the second quarter, I believe he got a shot blocked one more time. He committed a turnover where he had the ball taken from him. He actually was going to sub out very early in the first quarter. He subbed out at the 6:30 mark of the first quarter, but Aldama went to the bench to sub in for him at like the 4-minute mark or the 4 minutes into the first quarter. So they were pulling Tillman out quickly, it seemed, regardless. So then he comes back in like for his normal rotation in the second quarter, but then does not play at all in the third quarter. We even get to see Kenneth Lofton Jr. come in. They played nine guys in the first half. In the second half, they played 10 because Lofton gets added to the rotation. Lofton had a great moment, a beautiful high-low pass where Jaren Jackson Jr. catches the ball at the elbow and then delivers a nice bounce pass. Shades of Mark Gasol to Zach Randolph. Give me more of that, please. But I thought maybe Tillman was hurt or just wasn't going to play in the second half. Then Tillman comes in and actually plays the start of the fourth quarter. He plays for 3 minutes and that's it. Were they keeping his minutes really, really low because he is actually going to play on Wednesday night and they need him to bang bodies with Jonas Valanciunas? I don't know, maybe. But it was really odd, or it was interesting, and I don't know the answer for why Tillman barely played. Of course, those Aldama and Jaren minutes have been good all season. Like I said, they have the best net rating of any two-man combinations on the Grizzlies this year with a minimum of 200 minutes played. But they started the second half with Ja and Desmond and Luke and Jaren and Santi. Maybe it was just using the regular season laboratory to try out some different stuff. They wanted to see the Jaren and Santi front court paired with this kind of all offense, 1 through 3, your top offensive options of Ja, Kennard, and Bane together. I'm not sure. Anyways, let's take a quick ad break and then I'll be right back to wrap up the show. Grizz fans, 2023-2024 Grizzlies season tickets are on sale now. Season tickets are the best way to guarantee your seats to the biggest matchups at the lowest prices all season long, as well as receive early access to 2023 playoff tickets before they go on sale to the general public. For more information, visit grizzlies.com/season tickets or call 901-888-HOOP today. All right, so Xavier Tillman finished scoreless, 0 points, got 4 rebounds, that 1 turnover, and, of course, only played 13 minutes, which is a little bit weird. Santi got, I guess, more minutes because of the lack of Tillman playing time. Santi Aldama finished with 8 points. He led the team with 11 rebounds, had 4 assists and a steal, made 1 out of 4 threes. Tyus Jones was rough. He missed all 6 of his field goal attempts, all of them 3-pointers. Once again, this is night and day sometimes with Tyus, where when he comes off the bench, he just gives you nothing. We've had more of those games. Like, I think there's been 4 of those games in the past, you know, month where he's given you 0 offensively as far as scoring. He still, of course, provides, you know, the ball movement, the ball handling. He had 5 assists and 1 steal in this one. Conchar was in the rotation after not being in the rotation against the Bulls, of course, with no Dylan Brooks. They had to have someone else to make the 9th man in this rotation. He went scoreless, missed 2 of his 3s. 1 of those 3s bounced off the side of the backboard. Not great. I mean, when you look at Conchar and Tillman both giving you very, very little, it's hard for me not to remind you, so I will, That these guys were your 11th and 12th men last year. Yes, Tillman's been really, really good filling in for Steven Adams recently. But when you have a game like this where he gets outplayed by a backup big like Drew Eubanks, you're like, ah, well, these guys were 11th and 12th guys last year. Of course, one of the guys ahead of them in the rotation last year was Zaire Williams. And Zaire Williams is basically done for the year. I mean, not injury-wise. He was out for this game with injury, but I would be shocked if Zaire plays playoff minutes and contributes in the postseason. But not a good game highlighting your team depth. Yeah, Roddy made those four threes and had 16 points, but Contra gave you zero. Tyus Jones gave you 2 points. Tillman, who's starting for you, gives you 0 points. As far as hoping that the Grizzlies' depth gets a little bit better with the return of Steven Adams, Taylor Jenkins addressed it before the game, saying the reevaluation process has begun. I don't know what that means. Apparently, he's gotten an MRI, and they're going to have multiple doctors look at it and come up with the plan. To me, dumb podcaster guy, that doesn't sound good, but maybe I'm just reading the context or I'm inferring things into that, which aren't actually there. You know, is he going to be back in 10 days when the Grizzlies playoffs start? I remain dubious. I remain skeptical. Could he come back 4 weeks from now when hopefully the second round begins? Again, I guess there's no way for us to know, but that seems more likely and hopeful. Can the Grizzlies get to the second round without Steven Adams? Of course, that's the hope. I think most Grizzlies fans would say yes. I do not think it is certain. I think it's going to be extremely hard to win a playoff series without Steven Adams. Would love to be wrong. Let's go ahead and sweep that first round series, and everyone can tell me I doubted for no reason. The standings right now, of course, the win, like I said, reduced the Grizzlies' magic number to 2. The Kings beat the Pelicans on Tuesday. Like I said, the Grizzlies play the Pelicans tonight. And I would assume, again, we're going to rest a lot of guys, and the Pelicans can pick up another win. Basketball Reference right now has like the probability for who the Grizzlies would face in the first round, like who's going to come out of the play-in and be the 7 seed. This, is again, is assuming the Grizzlies end up as the 2 seed. The odds are extremely high. The Grizzlies do end up as the 2 seed. The probabilities of the Grizzlies' opponent are split incredibly equally. There are 5 probable opponents at this point. The Pelicans, the Timberwolves, the Lakers, the Warriors, and the Clippers. Basketball Reference, their probability says there's a 25% chance it's the Pelicans, a 22% chance it's the Timberwolves, a 20% chance it's the Lakers, an 18% chance it's the Warriors, and a 15% chance it's the Clippers. Now, those numbers are going to change a lot on Wednesday night when the Clippers and Lakers play. The loser of that game is going to have their probability jump up a bunch, because the winner of that game is going to be in a much better position to miss the play-in completely and end up as the 6 seed or maybe the 5 seed. So that will be fun to monitor. As far as other Grizzlies news, I guess I can mention that a new collective bargaining agreement was agreed to, so there will be no labor stoppage in the NBA. How the new CBA affects the Grizzlies, I'll be honest, I have no idea. I know they are adding another two-way spot, and the Grizzlies seem to love finding players and putting them on two-way deals. I mean, every team does, but the Grizzlies have some success of finding contributors that way. So maybe adding another Grizzlies two-way player is going to be an advantage for the team, but it seems like all teams would benefit. The rest of the stuff, I mean, it's hard to say if any of it specifically helps or hurts the team. I do know they're going to be operating probably over the cap for a while now, while Ja Morant goes through his prime, and thus the exceptions, the mid-level exception, and the luxury tax rules are going to affect the Grizzlies, probably, as we hope Robert Parra continues to spend and hopefully bring in even more help in the offseason, or maybe trade for another guy who might be on a near max or max contract. And thus, we'll have to pay attention to how, you know, being punished for being a luxury tax team is handled in this one, and if that really hampers or limits what the Grizzlies feel like they can do. But again, no idea. This is not my expertise, and we don't even know all the details of the new CBA yet. Anyways, I appreciate you listening to this episode. Hope you enjoy watching the Grizzlies on Wednesday night. I'll have a new episode up again tomorrow. Hope you have a great Wednesday. Talk to you soon. Go Grizz.